afternoon, everybody. I'm Dr. Sharon Squires, and welcome to Sociology 315, The Sociology of Work. This class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. Classes are broadcast live on this cable television channel and webcast on the internet each week. This spring, we will be broadcasting four classes: Political Science 335, International Politics, on Tuesdays from 7 to 9 p.m., Communications 100, Mass Media in Society, on Saturdays from noon to 1:40 p.m., Communications 300, Organizational Communications, on Saturdays from 1:50 to 3:30 p.m., and this class, The Sociology of Work, Sociology 315, on Sundays from noon to 2 p.m. If you've completed the first 2 years of college, you could earn your degree by enrolling in any of these classes. All of the classes you need to complete your bachelor's degree will be broadcast on this channel during the next 2 years and then started over. If you would like more information on the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, visit our website at www.appliedstudies.tv or give us a call at 1-866-278-6789. Welcome, welcome, welcome to Sociology of Work. We are almost done with the class because, as you know, this class actually ends a little bit earlier than the rest of the semester, so we only have a few more sessions left. Next session, we're going to talk about sweatshops and also forced sex work. A lot of you have been asking me about that. After that, we will talk about entrepreneurship and have another guest. And then finally, we'll talk about retirement, aging and work, and future work. What do we all intend to do with ourselves in the next couple of years? And so think about where we've went. I always do this. We've come through the global environment of work. We've talked about unions. And I want to go back just a second and visit the unions because I want to keep us updated with what's going on. So let's go directly to our first clip. And when we come back, so let's look at Wisconsin union protests. Let's take a look at the myths versus the facts.
What did Hitler do first? He busted the unions, right? First you take away the unions, and then you take away the Jews, and then you take away, you know, that's where it starts.
We must remain vigilant to have our voices heard. We must remain strong. We must retain the energy that I have felt since Monday when the students came with their Valentines to the Capitol.
Unions. He's busting the unions. And so what he's trying to do is take away the right of our unions to negotiate our contracts by saying he would tell us what we're going to get.
This debate has gone beyond just Wisconsin. And as you see people being bussed in from all over the country now, even President Obama has weighed in on this issue. They have made Wisconsin ground zero.
This has nothing to do with the budget shortage. Governor Walker has cooked up the books.
And we've already said that. It's not about money. It's about rights.
To call this budget bill, a budget fix bill, is nonsense. It's a union busting bill.
And it's not about balancing the budget. Governor Walker keeps saying it's about balancing the budget. It's not. It's about taking away people's rights to bargain for their contracts.
From your perspective, it is about collective bargaining. From our perspective, it is about the money. The state of Wisconsin is broke. You can't just keep growing your budget when you don't have money. People during this recession and downturn, they're tightening their belt buckles. They're asking us to do the same here in the state of Wisconsin.
Yeah, you know, people need to tighten their belts, but you know, the working people of Wisconsin, especially public workers, state workers, have all been tightening their belts.
Thank you.
this is not at all about spending. This has got nothing to do with money. We've been taking cuts forever.
You are on an unsustainable path as a state, and we don't want to become California. California's biggest problem was the public employee benefits.
I think we're willing to make concessions and do what we have to do. We understand the situation, but we also want to do it in a way that's going to be fair and in a way that can give everybody a voice. And then come to the table and talk to us. Give us a chance to speak and work together. We've always been willing to talk and work together.
We have negotiated in the past. The problem is we're out of that negotiating ability. We don't have anything to give anymore. And just to give you an example of how difficult it is, even last session with a democratically controlled Assembly, Senate, and the Democrat governor, it took 18 months to go through the collective bargaining process for our public employees.
If the unions bust here, get busted up here, it's going to be like a house of cards, and all unions across the United States are going to be broken.
It happens here, it's going to keep going in other places all around the country. And it's really scary. It really is like pre-Nazi Germany.
And personally, I do not want Walmart corporations or Disney corporations teaching the children of the United States.
Okay, one of the things I want you to think about are the differing perspectives on what's going on. Professor Jennifer Lowenstein from the University of Wisconsin said the repercussions of passing this bill in Wisconsin actually sends us 50 years back in terms of our labor relations, in terms of our collective bargaining. And so, but think about this, and how do we know what's accurate? What is really going on? What percentage of this budget problem is really caused by public workers and unions? And one of the problems that you have and I have, even doing the research for this, is that the places where we go for our data are now politicized. And so when you go to various news agencies to find out what's going on, you have to be aware that you're finding out about what's going on from a particular perspective. And so we want to look at all perspectives. When we talked about unions, I showed a clip from Rachel Madcow, and she basically argued that this was not about money. This was pretty much an attack on the Democratic Party, and this was an attack on workers. And Wisconsin is not broke. So let's take a look at our second clip, and this is just something to give you more stuff to think about.
An estimated 25,000 people demonstrated at the Wisconsin State Capitol today. On this third day of massive protests, there was no one covering the protests in Wisconsin better than my next guest, host of The Ed Show, my friend Ed Schultz. Ed is outside the Capitol in Madison, Wisconsin. He joins us live. Ed, my friend, thank you so much for being here. Please, please tell us what's going on, where you are right now.
Rachel, it's great to be with you tonight. This has been a very interesting experience doing this story in New York and kind of getting a sense of what it was like from afar. And then being here today in Madison, it has reaffirmed my instincts that the passion here is very strong. And I don't see any conclusion to this story anytime soon. The governor of Wisconsin today took a big political hit. He lost round one when he tried to get a vote, and the Democrats walked out and went to Illinois. And there have been a number of people, including myself, I've called out some of the Democratic leadership nationally, and to his credit, Senator Dick Durbin answered tonight. The Illinois senator went on record supporting the protesters here in Madison, Wisconsin, saying that workers across the country should have the right to stand together for fair compensation and a safe workplace. He went on to say Wisconsin teachers and state workers should not be badgered by a government governor who refuses to sit down and work out a fair compromise. And that really is what this story is all about. It's been some real heavy political browbeating on the middle class in Wisconsin, going after the firefighters, going after the teachers and the nurses, and also the public workers here who have given their hearts and soul to their jobs and careers, chasing the middle classers down to try to fix what some people view as a very bogus and ginned up financial crisis in this state. And this governor is backed by the Tea Partiers, and we definitely are going to show the infrastructure tonight on our show exactly who the people are that are backing this governor. You get a sense that he is way off base, that he may have won the election, but now on February 17th, just a few months later, so much has changed in this state because this agenda is just so radical and people just aren't willing to be browbeaten here. And the attack on unions, I had a nice visit with Harold Schaefberger of the Firefighters Association not long ago. He stopped by to see me tonight. He says, Ed, this is coming fast and furious. What's happening here in Madison, what's happening here at Ground Zero is what they are affectionately calling it, is happening all over the country. The union busting and the attempts to break up labor. 13 states are looking at paycheck deception type of legislation. Three bills have already passed in Oklahoma that are anti-worker, and now it's into Iowa. 12 states are dealing with right-to-work issues, and 5 states with dues deduction issues, which is huge. And it is all about the money. And if there has ever been a group of people that get it, these people here in Wisconsin get it. The focal point and the protesting is taking place here in Madison, but you get a real sense, Rachel, that it is groundswell support by average Wisconsins who now realize, Wisconsinites, who realize what is going on and what is at stake. We are talking about thousands of dollars of discretionary money to these middle-class workers, and the top 2%ers aren't being asked to do anything. And it's not a shared responsibility at all. And all the Democrats did today was step away to buy some time and not giving this governor this political victory because it has been very partisan and very heavy-handed.
Ed, I got to say, seeing you there, look, can we put up that white?
Okay. And what I want you to think about when you're seeing these clips is where is the information coming from? What is accurate? How do we know what is really, really going on if where we're getting our news source, our information, they're playing politics with the information? Either Wisconsin is broke or it is not. And I want to give you a little extra credit. Go out and find what the actual Wisconsin budget situation is. Once you find that out, then you will be able to understand a little bit about what the two warring sides are talking about. But you have to do your own research, and in order to do your own research, you have to go past blogs. So you have to go and look for news sources and state reports and all of that. And this is what makes it so problematic for us. Look at what's going on with the NFL. The players have decertified their union, and the union representative kind of backed away from the table on Friday, and now it's going to be up to the courts to decide what is going to go on with our major sport. And so this does have repercussions all through our society. By dissolving the union, the football league has cleared the way for individual players to file antitrust lawsuits against the league. So this opens even more issues as it relates to work, which likely could bar could be barred from locking out those players. So I'm reading the prompter as I'm trying to talk to you, but basically it boils down to the fact that we are seeing the fall of unions, but how is that ultimately beneficial or negative for our society? So extra credit, go out and find out what the real statistics are on Wisconsin. That way you'll be able to understand for yourself what's going on, because the truth is somewhere between Fox and MSNBC. And I used to say it was CNN, but I'm not really sure where CNN is right now. But that's one issue that is going to continue to come up because we rely on the media for our information. I also wanted to wrap up what we talked about last week, and that was men. And remember, we talked about men and work. So just to kind of focus on the high points, one of the things that is interesting to understand is we do live in a patriarchal society. Males are in the most dominant positions of power. However, not every man is powerful. Not every man is rich. So one of the things that has happened over the course of our study, over the course of changing paradigms, is that we've homogenized men as well. And we don't understand that men of different statuses are experiencing the world differently. So I want you to think about this in terms of work. Work is connected to men's sense of identity. And so when we talk about retirement, retirement is much more difficult for men because this is how they define themselves. And so men are also undergoing the most dramatic employment changes. Yes, minorities are entering the workforce, women are entering the workforce, but what this means is that men are actually being moved around as well as the society globalizes and as all of these people move into what was considered traditionally male work. All right, we have our first caller. Hi, Morris, how are you doing?
Oh, hi, Professor Sharon. I'm so happy to see that you are brought this attention about what's going on in Madison, Wisconsin.
Mm-hmm.
And I was one of those SEIU members and shop steward who boarded the plane, a charter plane, to go to Madison in solidarity with our people there.
Would you tell us what's going on there? What exactly do you think is happening in Madison?
This is an attack on the average middle-class wage earner.
Mm-hmm.
We feel that it was discriminatory for Governor Scott Walker to not bring any charges against the firefighters as well as the police department who were in solidarity with us, knowing that if we were going to be attacked or if the teachers were going to be attacked, they were next, even though they were contributors to his campaign to win as governor. What we have found is that he was not willing to allow us to come to the table. It was almost as though it was a dictatorship as opposed to a democracy.
Okay.
And one of our one of our major things was, what's disgusting? Union busting. That was one of our rallies.
Okay.
Another one is, show me what democracy looks like.
And
this is what democracy looks like.
So the major issue that you're having is that it's really about collective bargaining.
Collective bargaining in the sense that we were denied the opportunity to come to the table to negotiate. That's a dictatorship.
Okay.
That's what's going on in Egypt and Liberia and those other Middle Eastern countries. They want a democracy.
Mm-hmm.
And here in America, these 13 different states are now under attack to take away our civil rights, our right to be able to negotiate. And what we're saying is that if it wasn't for unions, we would not have middle-class wage earners today in America.
Okay.
They want to have the rich and the poor.
And today we're actually getting into a discussion about women, but it is also appropriate to say if it wasn't for unions, we wouldn't have as many women in some of the industries that we have them in, and also they wouldn't be making the wages that they're making.
Excellent point, Professor Sharon.
Yeah.
And the reason why that's an excellent point is because, as you know, throughout America, the majority of our teachers are whom? Women.
Correct.
And so this is an attack on women in Madison, Wisconsin, and throughout America. I am so grateful and thankful that you are bringing the attention to the women, because their money to be able to afford to do this, and they deserve it.
Thank
our
you.
Women deserve it. Our women have been the backbone of this country, and I can't begin to tell you how disgraceful and how stingy and how selfish and how greedy this is. We know, those of us that are intelligent individuals know, that this all derived from Wall Street.
Well,
this all derived from Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac.
It's
and now they want to bring it down to us.
You know, Morris, it's very interesting because what you're pointing out is that the dialogue needs to be a lot bigger. What's going on in Wisconsin and California and all of the states that are bankrupt is not just about the teacher's pension. And so we're reducing all of these social changes to what is going on with this population. So thank you so much for calling. And I want you to think about what he said. If you look at the protesters and you look at what is seen out in the street, it is a lot of mothers and grandmothers because they are the ones that do much of that state service type work. And so one of the interesting things is that we can talk about what's going on in Wisconsin in terms of women's rights as well. Because remember, if women are kind of seen as slightly oppressed, then any further removal of their rights is really going to make a big difference. So if you're out there and if you like this conversation, tell your friends to tune in because we really want to understand, you know, we're almost at the end of this class, so we really need to see what work is looking like now and what possibly is going to come. And Wisconsin is an outstanding example of what's coming. Frank says the antitrust suit prohibits monopolies. The NFL is indeed a monopoly. If the NFL is broken up, it would still be possible to have union representations with other unions. And think about this. We talked about corporations. And I don't want to just have a wild, blatant attack on corporations. Let's say you guys invented the next great mousetrap. You incorporated. You made lots and lots of money. Now you are a multinational conglomerate. And you are now responsible. You're now one of these people that we're talking about. What is your role in making sure that it is fair for the employees, not just for the corporation? So one of the things we don't even talk about is the fact that corporate definitions need to change if we want to see any of this. But I'm getting a little ahead of myself, so let's go back to work. First, let's realize women have always worked. And so there is this belief that somehow in the 50s, all of these women who sat around on pedestals all day long basically just got up and decided, you know, it was time for us to go to work. That is not the case. Women have always been responsible for the maintenance of the community. So whether it is the hunter-gathering role, whether it is the hut-building role in certain traditional societies, only women build the dwellings. So women are the only people that build the houses or whatever. So whether it is that, peasant women worked alongside men in the fields for the king. They might have done slightly different work, but they also worked. African slave women worked in the fields next to African slave men, and in addition, they also had the child care responsibilities and also the house responsibilities, so they definitely worked. Poor women. We always talk about working, and we don't realize that women are also classed in our society. So when we talk about that woman that was up on the pedestal, we're talking about a certain class of woman. Poor women in the United States, in the West, they helped settle the West, they helped build those farms, they helped, you know, all of those settlements and ranches. We just don't value what women have done. And so there is a lot of discussion about how women have contributed. But it's only been in the last couple of years since the feminist literature that we even consider housework as work. So let's take a look at one aspect where women actually rose to the occasion when they needed to, and they are only getting credit now for what they have done. So let's take a look at our World War II pilots.
To some pioneers, aviators who were not allowed to fly combat but flew supply missions, and they volunteered right here in America, blazing a trail across the sky during World War II. They had names like Dini and Eloise, Florence and Betty. Their planes had names like Pistol Pack and Mama, and together, 1,100 of them flew 60 million miles. They had all learned how to fly on their own, volunteers whose work freed up the men who would then fly combat. But when the war was over, they had to pay their own way home.
All we ever asked for is that our overlooked history would someday no longer be a missing chapter in the history of World War II, and most especially the history of America.
And today, they came. Bernice then, Bernice now, age 89. She was flown to Washington as an honored guest on AirTran, flown by an all-female crew. And today at the Capitol, at long last, the women Air Force service pilots were given by a grateful nation their just salute.
What is very interesting is that oftentimes the work of women is what supports the movement. And so we hear this idea that women are working behind the scenes. Even think about something like the civil rights movement. When you think about that, you automatically think about men. But guess what? All of that stuff, the coordination and all of that stuff, there were tons and tons of women in the background, talking, getting arrested, making the plans, setting the arrangements. Remember, the women were the secretaries. And if you know anything about work, your office is pretty much as good as your secretary. That is the person who keeps everything running. That's the person who knows where everything is. So a lot of these movements, the war needed the support of these women. They were essential. It just simply wasn't a nice thing to do. They provided the assistance that allowed them to win. So the first point is that women always worked. As we move through the decades, the idea about what women should do actually begins to change. And so in the 40s, women were basically, if you think about what was going on in the 1800s, then you have the labor movement, you have women kind of, in a way, almost coming into their own. So you have the secretarial pool, and now it was appropriate to go work in women's professions. And so you could work, but it was kind of what you could do is what made a difference. So let's take a look at an old film from the 1940s on women and working.
Joe Haley, there's one thing I'll say for you. You've done a good job. You know how to handle men, and you know how to keep the line moving.
Thanks, Mr. Brooks.
You work hard, Joe. You're a good foreman. Yes, women workers do present problems, Joe. It's tough, I know, but there are thousands of others, just like you, all over the country, facing the same problems. Pretty generally, you'll all find about the same answers.
Well, I know most of the answers as far as the men are concerned.
Well, I think we can say that the broad principles involved in the supervision of men apply equally well in the case of women.
That ain't what I learned about women.
There are some new and different problems, Joe. I'll admit that.
Women scare me. At least, they do in a factory.
Well, maybe the women are scared too, Joe. Let's see. It takes time to make them feel at home, but it can be done.
You talk like a man who knows women.
We'll see, Joe. We'll see.
How did it go today, Joe?
Oh, all right.
You troubled about something?
No, everything went all right, Molly, but...
You know, I had 7 requests for time off today. Well, I guess women don't realize what it means to stick on the job.
Maybe they don't.
Well, Joe, this all boils down to 4 things to remember. 1, don't mix pleasure with business. 2, women can be awfully jealous of each other. 3, avoid undue familiarity. And finally, women are more sensitive than men.
I'll say they're sensitive. They give you an argument, and a crazy one at that.
Yes, a man probably would have kept the argument about himself and not trapped the foreman the way she did.
What do you mean, trapping?
Oh, Lord bless me. It's an old stunt, Joe. You go after a woman worker on one point, and she switches the issue.
Well, why limit that to women?
Now, the issue was, why wasn't she wearing a cap?
Yeah.
And she switched him to the fact that the other girls weren't wearing theirs. And all he did was stand on his dignity. A bit stuffily, I might say. Now, if she had been a man, he wouldn't have laid down a safety rule so arbitrarily. You know, Joe, you've got to tell them the why of every rule, particularly women.
Okay, it sounds like they're talking about kids. Don't mix business with pleasure. Women are jealous beings. Stop any kind of undue familiarity. And women are very, very sensitive. And so this clip does a really nice job of kind of outlining the stereotypes. Are they stereotypes that women have had to address in terms of the workforce? So even when she is not in acting in any of these ways, people still may perceive her to be doing so. And this goes back to our long idea of women. Women tend to negotiate more. Women tend to talk more. Women tend to want to understand. And he says, look, you have to basically explain everything to them. And so this is a little bit of history in terms of how we see women and working. But let's move on to today. Let's talk about work and family today. USA Today reported on a study that talked about data from about 1,000 American workers. And basically what they found is men and women react differently to emotional stressors at work. Remember, we talked about that in terms of men. And they said women actually react with more distress when work begins to infringe on their personal life. So when the work starts to infringe on the time with the kids and the kids' bath time, according to the USA study, women seem to exhibit a little bit more stress about that. And part of the conclusion they came to is because of the traditional gender roles. This is her area. This is her sphere of influence. And so when the job infringes there, she's having to then do both roles at the same time. So talk to her boss while giving the kids a bubble bath. If she doesn't give the kids a bubble bath, it's much more socially problematic as a mother to say, you know something, I'm going to let the kids go to sleep nasty. I'm going to go talk to the boss. So women feel as if they have to do everything. And this has been one of the issues and one of the problems that women face. Let's take a look at our next clip on working moms.
So a few months ago, I was in New York pitching a deal. I'm sitting in a room with 5 men, which I probably wouldn't have noticed, except that 2 hours in, we all kind of stood up to go to the bathroom, and everyone filed out of the room, and the senior partner kind of got red and realized he didn't know where the women's bathroom was in his own office. And I said, is it possible that I'm the only woman to have pitched a deal in this office in the year you've been here? And he said, well, maybe. Or maybe you're the only one who had to go to the bathroom. So this is the problem, and it's not about the bathroom. I graduated from business school. My classmates were very talented, the men and the women. It's been 15 years of the people I know, every single man is working full-time, and almost none of my female friends. And they left. We all started together in the workforce. It's the women who left. And they left because, as Arit said, they had two jobs and their husbands had one. When a man and a woman both work full-time, studies show that the woman does 3.5 times more housework and childcare than the man. And they also left because their husbands were making more money. Due to the choices they'd made, their husbands had higher earning, so if one person was going to step back, it made more economic sense for the family. I think we all lose because of this. We lose because our companies aren't as profitable, as Martin said. We lose because we waste talent. We need more leaders like Muhtar at Coca-Cola to really champion this. I think most importantly, we limit women's ability to contribute in the workforce, and even more importantly, we limit men's ability to contribute at home. I think it's too late for my generation, sadly. I think we'll make some progress and hopefully get some women back, but we're not going to change the numbers at the top. But it's not too late for my goddaughter, who started college as a freshman this year, and it's definitely not too late for my children. I have a 2-year-old daughter and a 4-year-old son, and I want more choices for both of them, both in the home and in work.
Okay, think about what she said. Women do 3.5 times more work. And so when you're talking about housework, and remember I gave you the statistics on what men did, and that is increasing, but it's not equal yet. And so what we find is that you do have women who work an 8-hour day and then come home and put in another 6 or 7 hours to do the other requirements of their gender role, and that is be a mother or be a wife. And so what is interesting is that one of the things she pointed out was that a lot of women end up leaving the workforce and having to choose that mother role over the work role if they're able, if their husbands make enough money to allow them to do that. All right, so what percentage of women work? When you're talking about it, in the 1950s, about 1 in 3 women participated in the labor force. It just was not expected. It was still relatively deviant at that time, even though there were secretaries and assistants and all of that. By 1998, nearly 3 out of every 5 women of working age were in the workforce. And when you're talking about women age 16 and over, the labor force participation was 33.9% in 1950 compared to 59.8% by 1998. So what we're seeing is a massive rise in the amount of women that are working. And there's a couple of reasons for this. First, what we're seeing is a change in the need, because the husband's income is not enough to support an individual family anymore. And we're also seeing this rise because of the nature of changes in women's social position or social roles. Women are now encouraged to go to school. As a matter of fact, they're beginning to make up on all the different levels the majority of people that are awarded higher degrees in this country. And so with that, women are turning those degrees into the workforce. When we look at women even 68 plus, 8.6% of women age 65 plus worked in 1998, as opposed to 9.7% in the 50s. So even older women in our contemporary society can still expect to work. It is a requirement. A lot of times women are turning to self-employment. And from 1979 to 2003, self-employment for women increased. And it went up by about 33% for women. And what is interesting is it went up quite a bit for African Americans, males and females included, 15% for Latinos, 10% for white Americans, and only entrepreneurship, 2.5% for men. And when you think about this, this represents a major change for men. And for you women that are out there watching, is your employer sensitive to the needs of your family? Do you have flex time? Are you able to stay home on those days when your child has the flu? And because these are some of the things we're going to have to look to towards the future, because I'm pretty sure everybody's going to be working soon. But as you can see, self-employment is going up for women, and just to keep it in a balance, it's going down on the other side for men. And this also represents a change as well, because all those self-employed women are now new women bosses. So when we talk about women in business, women represent more than a third of all people involved in entrepreneurial activity. And so women are very much in the business world. Between 97 and 2002, women-owned firms grew by about 19.8%, while all U.S. firms grew by about 7%. So women are in the forefront of starting this new economy, getting involved, and you're more likely to see more women in positions of shop foreman, etc., like the woman in the image. Women-owned business firms accounted for 6.5% of total employment in U.S. firms in 2002. And this is really interesting, because when we start talking about changes in business and what is going to happen in terms of the future of business, we're also talking about businesses that are going to be ever increasingly dominated by women. Is that going to make a difference when young ladies like the woman in the background are now the corporate owners? Is this going to matter that we're talking about corporations? When you do the day rule, remember we talked about that website that let you link all these corporate players? Well, if you play with that site, you will see that there's some fat cat women that are playing in this economic game that actually have a lot of power and influence. And so are we moving towards that? The number of women-owned firms continues to grow at twice the rate of the U.S. average. And so even with the changing economy, women are still moving forward. There's an estimated 10 million women-owned privately held U.S. businesses. And so what is happening in the economy is directly connected to what is going on with these new young entrepreneurs. Women are more likely to seek business advice as opposed to men. 69%, almost 70% of women are going to go looking for advice, whereas only 47% of men will. And someone called in last week and asked me what men could do for these changes. Well, one of them relates to this number. Go and find out what are the current trends in the business market. What is going on in the business world, and how do you adapt to that? Because, as the statistics say, a good portion of men are not asking for this kind of advice. All right, so let's go back and talk a little bit about mothering and business. How do we bring these two things together? And really, with the rise of feminism and feminist literature in universities, we actually begin to get some questions about mothering, whereas mothering is kind of made problematic. And when you talk about mothering, the rise of feminism actually led to some really important questions regarding mothering. First of all, was it worthwhile for women to mother? Is mothering a form of oppression, or is mothering the best job you could ever have? Is mothering labor, and should it be valued as such in the society? And what is that worth? And also, with the rise of the feminist literature, there came the question, could women do it all? So could we be Rosie the Riveter and go home and breastfeed at the, you know, 2 minutes later and then go and do the carpool or whatever it is? But these were all questions that came up as a result of women beginning to look at their social role. The liberal feminists, and we're not going to go too far into this, but they basically argued that mothering should be valued. We need to look at it in terms of its worth. We need to look at it in terms of its contribution to the larger society. We don't think about it, but mothering is really important. You know, mothering and fathering, the two jobs that go actually back, you know, since the beginning of time, how do we reward that? How are we structuring that for the individuals playing these roles? Now, the radical feminists, on the other hand, and this is what most people might be familiar with, they argued that mothering was oppression. Mothering, being married, was basically more of a benefit for a man. And what women got out of it was the ability to do two jobs and to not really be rewarded. And so coming out of this literature came a question of, should women work, do women work, and what is that value? So let's take a look at attitudes of women working in the 50s.
Today in the press and on the radio, the American career girl, married or single, is a favorite subject for discussion. One radio program which has explored the subject is What Makes You Tick, presided over by moderator John McCaffrey with the aid of two psychologists, Leon Ahrens and Sidney Roslow.
All right, Miss Bates. We'd like to try to find out how determined a career girl you are. Now, if you'd please answer these questions, and here is your first question. How confident are you in business dealings with your superiors?
Oh, pretty confident, I think.
Well, now, do you ever feel like telling off the boss?
I certainly do.
Well, do you ever do it?
Well, not very often.
How capable do you feel yourself of handling any business emergency?
I think I'd be able to manage most any emergency.
Then you consider yourself a pretty efficient executive?
Yes, I think so.
Why, Miss Bates?
Well, I suppose it's because I feel I can make decisions fairly easily and, make them for others and tell them what to do. I've been doing that, you know, for almost a year now, in a small way.
Do you feel that some girls have too much talent and ability to waste on a home and children?
Yes, I think many girls do. Some girls have a great deal to offer, and they certainly don't make any contribution to the business world, sitting home with their children or cooking dinner for their husband.
Go on, Miss Bates.
Well, many talented girls deserve a better life than that. They need that feeling of independence, of competition that they don't get at home, and they deserve the luxuries that they can buy with the money they earn.
Would you give up your career if the right man proposed?
No, I wouldn't. My career means too much to me.
Not even if your dream Prince Charming were the man?
I haven't met him. I don't think I'd give up my career even so.
Do you ever read love stories, Miss Bates?
Well, occasionally.
Do you ever picture yourself in the situation the heroine finds herself in?
Yes, I do sometimes.
Then you have thought about yourself in the character of a wife?
Yes, I have, but in a very detached sort of way. Never really seriously, of course.
Do you believe you'll realize your career ambitions within the next 5 years?
Yes, I do.
Thank you, Miss Bates. Now we'll find out how determined a career girl our judges rate you. Dr. Roslow?
With 100 as the maximum possible rating, we rate Miss Bates at 62. She says she would not give up her career for marriage, yet she has a definite yearning for romance.
Miss Bates' determination to continue with her career obviously has not yet been severely tested.
Okay, so what they're saying is, hey, if a cute guy comes along, she's going to give up that job in a minute, because she reads love stories and romance novels. And this actually poses a problem. Is it possible to read love stories and romance novels and do the things that many women do and still be career-minded? And so when we have the rise of the 50s with Betty Friedan's The Feminine Mystique, when we realize that, hey, women do tick, There's something more going on up there. Well, this question of whether mothering was enough came out into the society. And I don't know if any of you have looked at it yet, but on Blackboard, I actually put a video from the Twilight Zone. And this video is called Little Boy Lost. And this video actually is, it's outstanding. It made me feel very, very melancholy when I saw it. It's about a young woman. She's a career woman. She's a photographer. And there's a man who loves her. He wants to marry her and have babies with her because his biological clock is ticking. And he says, hey, don't take this dream job. Stay here, be my wife, have my kids. Well, as she's going out taking pictures, she actually meets the child she would have if she gave up her career and stayed with this gentleman. And so the story is about this, her interactions with this young boy. And at some point she says, you know, I'm really sorry. This is just a decision that I have to make. And she says, I'm going to have kids later on. He says, yeah, but it won't be me. It's not going to be me. I won't be here. It'll be some other kid from the Twilight Zone that you'll have. And basically, as she made her decision, the young man begins to disappear out of her photos. Because in terms of her career path, she chose career over mothering. You know, and it was very interesting because there's one point in it where she basically breaks down. You know, she's talking to him. He's trying really hard to get born. And she says, no, I can't do it at that time. And so when you think about it, women for a long time have had this dilemma. What did the young girl say? She said there are a lot of women wasting their talent sitting around at home cooking, cooking dinner. They could have a much better life. And so this issue of mothering versus working came down to which was going to make you more fulfilled as a woman. To have a career, earn your own money, and have all of the trappings that go along with that, or to be a mom and raise the next generation and all of the trappings that go along with that. One of the things that came out during this time, and I was in graduate school when this discussion was huge about mothering and women's responsibilities as a mother or to herself. Well, there came a lot of Freudian psychoanalytic discussions of mothering. And one of the famous ones was Nancy Chodorow, The Reproduction of Mothering. And she says, basically, it's almost like a psychosocial development. We learn mothering through our mothers. We identify with our mothers. And we pick up these roles from our mothers. And we feel almost compelled to then follow through and act in these roles. Whereas sons break away from their mothers. Women have to go through this process of identity and then self-identity. And so there was a lot of discussion on the role of mothering in terms of the woman's psyche. And so I want to stop there. We're going to take a 10-minute break. And when we come back, we're going to talk about men and women in the corporation and also the glass ceiling. And so let's take our break, and when we come back, we'll finish our discussion.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Ladies and gentlemen, and particularly Senator Ted Lieu and your beautiful wife Betty and your family, welcome to the 55th Assembly District, now a part of, as you well know, the 28th Senate District, which you now represent. Ladies and gentlemen, it's always great to have such pomp and circumstance to remind all of us of the role of government and the important work that we do.
I'd like to ask the Honorable Ted Lieu to come on stage, and with the Chairman of the Board of Equalization, Jerome Horton, a former California State Assembly member and Inglewood City Council member, and, as you heard, a graduate of this fine institution, to administer the oath of office.
I state your name.
Tad Lou.
Do solemnly swear that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
Against all enemies.
Against all enemies.
Foreign and domestic. That I take this obligation freely. With Betty's permission.
Without any mental reservations.
Or purpose of evasion. And that I will well and faithfully discharge the duties. Upon which I am about to enter. By the power vested in me, I hereby announce and present to all of you the Senator Ted Lieu.
Teatro Dominguez is a multicultural theater company here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. And the program is designed to do play readings, workshops, and folktale tours to local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is that we are not doing theater so much as entertainment, doing theater to help make our lives better. It is community service first and theater second. So, for instance, Teatro would do a play reading of a play about assimilating into American culture if you're an Asian immigrant. And that may be performed in a middle school or here on campus. A number of teachers ask Teatro Dominguez to come into their classrooms to read scenes. We have workshops where we would bring a group like Culture Clash in or Cornerstone Theater Company to help our students learn about community-based theater creation. And the touring show is always interesting. Every year we take a folktale or we create a folktale of our own, which is animals talking in masks, and we tour it to local second grade classrooms. So what Teatro does is really educational theater. It is theater that focuses on social issues, and it has more of a direct purpose for society.
Hi, my name is Calvin Coe, and I'm a transfer student from Cal State Fullerton, and I am currently a junior. And the reason why I chose Cal State Dominguez Hills is because of their digital media arts program. And the reason why I like this school is they have great instructors, all the classes are hands-on, and they have great staff.
Hi, I'm Tiffany from Cal State Dominguez Hills Athletics Department, and welcome to the Toros Coach's Corner. This edition, we have the head women's volleyball coach with us, Scott Davenport. Welcome, Coach.
Thanks, Tiff.
All right. Although the team didn't finish as well as hoped, it played probably in the toughest league in America, the CCAA. Tell us what the team learned from that experience and what we can look forward to this year.
Well, I think they learned a lot about preparation. You know, and we've been trying to impart them certain behavior and how they have to model to improve, you know, each week in and out. But preparation is the big thing.
That core that you're referring to, returning players, is this the year that we challenge the elite teams in the conference with those returners?
Being an optimist, I'd like to say yes. I think the core of returning players, they know what we expect of them. They know what we expect them to teach and lead the incoming players.
And what can people expect to see when they come out to watch the Toros this season?
Well, we're going to kind of focus on tenacious defense. That's kind of what we're going to be known for. We're going to go after our serves. We're going to try to keep every ball alive. We're going to run a very fast offense, too. So a lot of speed, a lot of energy. Let's expect what you can see.
Well, Coach, I'm sure I speak for many when I say I can't wait to see you guys this season in action. And I just want to thank you for joining us on this edition of the Toros Coach's Corner. And until we see you in the stands, remember to make every day your masterpiece. Go Toros.
Go Toros.
Good evening and welcome to the unveiling of the CSUDH All-America Wall of Honor. In this very room, we have athletic All-Americans, academic All-Americans, and Rhodes Scholar finalists.
A number of you in the room tonight are those scholar athletes who have been part of the history here.
And I want to welcome and thank you for coming to celebrate this historic occasion at CSU Dominguez Hills. It's a thrill to have all of you back on campus.
One, two, three.
And I'm coming to Dominguez Hills from Sacramento. My major is clinical science, and I chose the school specifically because they offer this major. The thing I like most about Dominguez Hills is the small class sizes and the ability to live on campus and be so close.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
Watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, everybody. Welcome back. I am Dr. Sharon Squires, and this class is Sociology 315, the Sociology of Work. It's part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. If you would like any information on this program, visit our website at www.appliedstudies.tv or give us a call at 1-866-278-6789. Where we left off was talking about women and women in business. And I want to shift and talk about women in the corporations. If you're interested in this topic, this is one of the books you should read, Men and Women of the Corporation by Rosa Beth Moss Cantor. And basically, in this book, she looks at the different roles that men and women play in the corporations, as well as the different expectations and opportunities they have within those corporations. And what she found was that it's the very structure of the corporation that actually influences and encourages the gender separation. And so she said even the way that it's designed, the way people are placed, has some impact on how they are able to interact. And she talks about the different roles that they're allowed to play and also how they are rewarded into those roles. And she says, first of all, sex polarization and segregation is ubiquitous in most occupations. There is men's work and there's women's work. And it's usually clearly defined. The people may even wear different colors for the different kinds of work. And she said, look, this idea of the glass ceiling, and I'll talk about that in a second, but she said this blockage to being able to get up is firmly in place in the structure of the organizations for women and minorities. And so women have been invited into the office, but they haven't been invited into management or the administration. And think about where deals are made, in the boardroom, in the lunchroom, on the golf course. And all of this has to do with networking. How do you do that if you're in the secretarial pool, for example? And she said, there's also an interesting thing about corporations where people may be rewarded in terms of normative awards, like praise or employee of the week, but this doesn't always translate into financial rewards. I always tell people, they're like, oh, you're such a great teacher. I'm like, send a check. Send a check. When I was working, I always said, you know, it's really good to get compliments. And I think at the job, women tend to get more compliments than money. And so I would always say, thank you for the compliment, send a check as well. So any of you women out there that are watching, what has been your experience in the workforce? Have you experienced discrimination? Do you feel as if you've experienced the glass ceiling? I think I mentioned this once, that when I was younger, I worked for a major TV studio, and I was like a student assistant, and there was me, and then there was also another student assistant who was a young guy, but he also had a family, and I was just a young girl going to college. And I was actually told by my boss that the reason, if I want to know, the reason that my raise was not as high as his was because he did have a family and he was expected to bring in more money. And I remember sitting there and I briefly tried to argue, but we do the exact same job. But I knew at that point that there really wasn't any way that I could win. And I was a young person and I was happy to get a check, but I knew that there was something really, really wrong with how I was being assessed here. And I thought, well, how will I ever get to support a family, you know, if they're going to continue to always want to pay me less? So if you've had any experiences like that, call in and let us know. But what is the glass ceiling? This term actually came into common usage in the 80s. And what it refers to as an invisible barrier. It's not clear, it's not in policy, it's not stated, but it's this invisible kind of assumption that, you know, women cannot get any higher. They shouldn't be promoted any further, or there's a natural limit. And if you think about it, the glass ceiling is directly related to these opinions we've seen from the 30s, the 40s, and the 50s. The idea that women are very emotional. I've often heard this said, just to take an aside, that people don't want a woman boss. Have you had different experiences with a woman as your boss or a male as your boss? Because part of this issue with the glass ceiling is that there is this level in terms of management or administration or control that women just can't break through. And it was actually coined in 1986 by, I'm going to totally mess up their names, but Carol Humwitz and Timothy Shellhard. And basically, they used this term, and it was later picked up, and it became part of our normal vocabulary. But really what it talked about is the fact that there was some type of little blockage. It was in the very beginning, and you read the glass ceiling literature, it's difficult to understand exactly what that ceiling is. But let's take a look at our next clip, and then when we come back, we'll talk about the kind of things that cause that ceiling to be so low. So let's look at the UC Davis glass ceiling study.
Will come as discouraging news tonight for young women just entering the business world or people trying to climb the corporate ladder.
A study released today by UC Davis shows that some of California's most well-known companies still have boardrooms that are essentially for men only. KCLA3's David Benick has been looking at the numbers and the reasons why. David?
Well, Sarah and Edie, this is the third year that researchers at UC Davis School of Management have done this glass ceiling study. And basically, the numbers were low and have remained unchanged. Only about 10% of women are making it to the top.
As one of the McClatchy newspaper company's vice presidents, Lynn Dickerson oversees more than 5,000 employees at 11 regional papers in the southeastern U.S.
Here's Hilton Head, South Carolina.
And after 27 years in the newspaper business, Dickerson still remembers when people assumed she must be a man.
Almost all my mail used to come to Mr. Lynn Dickerson instead of Mrs. Lynn Dickerson.
According to the study released by UC Davis at this Women in Business conference today in Sacramento, men dominate corporate life even now in 2007, even in California.
We expected California to stand out as a leader compared to other states, and California's right in the mix.
In fact, this study shows at the biggest 400 companies in the state, women make up only 10% of the executive workforce. And some well-known California companies, such as Apple, Callaway Golf, and the Skechers USA Shoe Company, have no female executives at all.
I have a head for business and a bod for sin.
Unlike in the 1980s, when movies such as Working Girl featured women simply trying to prove they could do the job, women's advocates say today's glass ceiling is often about having to make difficult choices.
Once you've got children at home, young children at home, and then you've got parents to be taken care of, you've got the whole spectrum of things going on. People are looking at how they can manage that and stay sane themselves.
At today's conference, a dozen companies did receive awards for helping employees balance work and family, including McClatchy, where VP Lynn Dickerson remains optimistic about the next generation of women in business.
I think those statistics will be changing because I do think that women are taking over the world.
So if you know somebody trying to get into business, what should she look at? Well, financial companies and healthcare companies ranked among the highest for women executives in California. The most male-dominated industries are communications and computer companies, often located in the Silicon Valley. Sarah.
David, thank you. Here's how some other Sacramento area companies ranked in the survey. Hewlett-Packard, which has a facility in Roseville, ranked 24th with 25% of women in top jobs. The aerospace company Gencorp, based in Rancho Cordova, came in at 79 with about 17% of women bosses. And SureWest Communications in Roseville was number 252 with fewer than 6%. To see a complete list, all you have to do is go to the...
Okay, think about this. When you're talking about women who make up more than half of the population, if there wasn't something in place, these numbers wouldn't look like this. There's clearly something that is stopping the majority of those women. It should be relatively even if we're using just simply merit. But think about how the glass ceiling works. Lower pay, and we clearly understand that. You're not a man and you're going to just simply make less. One of the things that is very interesting about universities is that this was also a major problem with universities. And so the research found that male PhDs coming out and going into pretty much entry-level jobs made more money than female PhDs just simply by nature of their maleness. They were offered more money. And so this is a problem everywhere. But it's not just money. It is less opportunities. When do you have an opportunity to network? When do you have an opportunity to demonstrate your enthusiasm or your creativity? As a matter of fact, I was looking and I left my notes, but one of the studies talked about the fact that when women demonstrated innovation at the job, it was often seen as negative. It wasn't seen the same way it was as if the man came up with the invention. When the woman came up with it, she's pushy, it wasn't instantly considered. And so there's a way of viewing men and women that limits their opportunity as well. With regards to my question, Deborah said, I had a female boss who consistently mothered all of her employees. We all loved her, but she was not able to discipline when it was needed, and she lost her job because of it. So really, let's talk about that, because there is an entire body of literature that questions the legitimacy of the glass ceiling. And what they argue is that it's not just simply external forces that are keeping women down, it's actually women themselves. And so one of the things relates to Deborah's comment. They come into the workforce and take on maybe that position of mother, not of executive, not of professional. And so they're not rewarded because of that position that they're holding. And the literature says that women are making choices in terms of what they do, how many hours they work, that make them not attractive to employees. One of the questions about this relates to young women coming into the workforce, and going all the way back to the question we have, how long are you going to work for me before you get married and go off and have babies? And so this, on the other side, is what people are saying. Look, employers have to consider all of this when looking at who to hire, and it makes women not as desirable or not as attractive. They're going to leave. You're going to then have to cover certain other health care issues, etc. And so this idea of the glass ceiling is not set. It's not agreed upon. Some people argue that there's actually not even as much of a glass ceiling, because once the women are given the opportunities, given the pay, given the ability, they're able to go up, but it's actually a sticky floor. Nothing comes along for them to hold on to be able to rise up. And so the question of a glass ceiling is a little bit problematic. And recently, there have also been some ideas of cracks in the glass ceiling, looking at women who have excelled. And international researchers have talked about the fact that when you look at this phenomena across cultures, there are actually a little bit of different reasons for why women in each different culture may be subordinate in the workforce. It's not uniform. They couldn't actually find a simple, clear case of uniform discrimination. In some of the areas, it was actually the choices that women were making in terms of work. They didn't pick the track that would send them to the CEO of that corporation. And so one of the issues, and this issue now, I want to shift gears a little bit and talk a little bit about pay. Because one of the issues with the glass ceiling is that women are not paid exactly what men are paid. And because of this, we see that they are not able to do the same kind of things with their paycheck that men would be able to do. So let's take a look at Equal Pay Women's Liberation.
The next step is to get them to pay me like a fella.
What do you mean by that?
Oh, they're putting me on regular next week, but they're paying me less than they paid the man who used to run the forklift.
Oh, well, come on, Irene. After all, it's a well-known fact. Men are worth more than women.
Archie, have you been reading Playboy?
No, Irene, the Bible.
Bible?
The Bible. And in the Bible, it says, God made man his own image. He made women after, from a rib. Cheaper cut.
is a man, and if he was getting paid $6 an hour, why should I get $5.50?
Because, Irene, you're getting what? You're getting $5.50 an hour?
Archie, that's exactly what they're paying you.
What they're paying me?
There goes your rib theory.
And there goes the whole company, meathead. When you see the day that they're giving women the same pay as men and giving women the same jobs, where the hell is it all going to end? What are you going to say when a woman is managing the Mets?
I'll say we have equality, right? Right. Right, Michael?
Let's think about that a minute.
Yeah, yeah. And while you're thinking about it, think about this. Equality is unfair. That's right. What's the point of a man working hard all his life trying to get someplace if all he's going to do is wind up equal?
All right, think about that for a second, because it brings together our last two lectures. One of the interesting things is that as women are arguing for equal pay and equal rights and all of that, it is also altering the landscape. And all men may not respond like Archie Bunker, but it is altering their landscape as well. Look at his face when he found out that she was actually making the same as him. I mean, he was, you know, really, really saying, hey, men are worth more. So even if she was doing the same job, that general belief that men are worth more is still what is pervasive in our society. When Hillary Clinton was running and when she was the first lady, she was really, really interested in this issue of equal pay. That women who are doing the same work should receive the same money. So let's take a look at our next clip and the next discussion.
You know, it's hard to build the future if you don't start by honoring the past. And March is Women's History Month, a great time to remember that women's work helped build this country. It's also an important time to make sure that women's work is valued, not just with fine words, but with fair pay. It's been 44 years since the Equal Pay Law was first passed, and there's been a lot of progress since then. So many barriers have been shattered. The possibilities for my daughter's generation exceed anything my mother could have imagined, even when I was growing up. But here we are at the beginning of the 21st century, and women still earn significantly less money than men for doing the same jobs. Women who work full-time, year-round, earn just 77 cents for every dollar that a man makes. And for women of color, it's even less. 67 cents for African American women for every dollar a man makes, and just 56 cents for Latinas. You know, that's a huge difference every single week when it comes to paying the rent or the mortgage or buying groceries or school supplies or covering the doctor's bills. Over a lifetime, the numbers really add up. Working women stand to lose $250,000 over the course of their careers because of unequal pay practices. And this is a problem for women no matter where we work. I read a story recently that Wimbledon finally agreed to pay their women tennis champions the same amount of prize money as their male champions. It only took 123 years for them to do the right thing. So what do we do? Well, I'm introducing a new bill called the Paycheck Fairness Act to help close the pay gap for women. First, it offers women meaningful remedies for pay discrimination by toughening the penalties for violating the Equal Pay Act. Now, that should help stop employers from discriminating against women. Second, it makes sure our government enforces equal pay laws in our own federal contracts. Millions of women are employed through federal contracts. We should at least be a model to the private sector about giving women an equal paycheck for equal work. Third, this bill prohibits employers from retaliating against employees who share salary information. Right now, when women try to find out if they're being treated fairly by asking around about what others get paid, they can get in trouble or even be fired. This bill would make that illegal. And finally, this bill requires the Department of Labor to continue collecting and disseminating information about women workers. You wouldn't think you would need a law to do that. But the Bush administration has stopped collecting some valuable information about women in the workplace, As with so many things, they seem to think the problems will go away if they make the facts go away. Well, I want to get back into the reality business with real solutions to the real problems people face. That's why I'm also working to expand family and medical leave, to cover sick leave, to increase funding for research into the connection between diseases like breast cancer and environmental hazards, to ensure that Title IX continues so that young women can compete. And we also have to make sure that we stay vigilant about protecting a woman's right to choose and smart about making family planning available. I hope you'll join this conversation about these and other important issues.
Now think about this. We've been having these same conversations now for years in terms of how women are going to be women in the workforce. There are things that women are not going to get away from. Women are always going to be mothers regardless of what's going on. How are we going to incorporate mothering into the public workforce? And periodically we've seen these bills come up, but originally the Equal Pay Act was passed in 1963. And this was an amendment to the Fair Labor Standards Act. And what this is was basically the Fair Labor Standards Act outlawed discrimination by sex, and this Equal Pay Act basically said that any employer could not discriminate in wage on the basis of sex. So they couldn't simply pay women less because they were women. And I mean, when you look back on it, when we look back historically, this is going to seem like such a simple thing. But it, as you can see, Hillary Clinton talking in the 90s was still talking about this because it hasn't been resolved in our society yet. And like I said, this is actually not a clear-cut issue. The same way the glass ceiling is contested, this idea of equal pay is also contested. And Warren Farrell, he is one of the writers in the men's rights movement. He talks about the difference between comparable pay and equal pay. And basically he says, look, there is something going on that we're missing out in our discussion. He says we need to be talking about comparable pay and not necessarily dollar for dollar equal pay. Because he says when we look at what men do and what women do, we're actually comparing apples to oranges. And how do you decide the value of that paycheck across those things? And he says men are more likely to make life decisions that lead to a higher salary. So they're more likely to make those family sacrifices early on, take the corporate job, whatever, where women, because of their other responsibilities, may not. He says males are more apt than women to relocate or travel for work. And so men are more flexible, which is much more attractive to a corporation if you're able to leave and travel. He says basically men take on more dangerous jobs. He said 90% of the workplace deaths are reported for men. So when we're talking about who's getting killed the most in the workplace, it's men. They're doing the much, much more dangerous work. And work in more of these men work in the difficult positions, and they really don't. Kind of what he's saying is that women are choosing jobs with shorter hours, more flexible, less danger. And so, therefore, it makes sense that they're going to be compensated at a lower rate. And compared to men, the majority of women generally favor jobs that involve little danger, no travel, and good social skills. Such jobs generally pay less. For women who earn over $100,000 a year, he says they are more likely than men to give up a portion of that pay to spend time with their families. And so You know, he's talking about the fact that we need to actually take a look at what men and women are actually doing in the workforce and talk about how do we compensate that comparably and how do we make sure, and remember, he's writing from the position of the men's movement. He's basically suggesting how do we make sure that we don't lose men and the men's rights in all of these shifts and changes as women get more into the labor force. Is it the same to compare, you know, jobs that don't necessarily have the same implied or actual level of difficulty? All right, so think about what Hillary said and why this is important. Women on average earn 77 cents where men earn a dollar. Well, think about it. If we round to say, you know, they earn 75 cents for every dollar that men make, think about that quarter. We're rounding off. Think about every paycheck, that quarter that is missing out of that paycheck. When I teach my other classes, we talk about single mothers and the fact that they're doing poorly. Many of them are in poverty. Well, women are not paid the same wage to support a family. That 25 cents makes a big difference in rent and groceries. And then when you break it down and start looking at it in terms of minority status, where African American women make 67 cents on that dollar, think about what you are not able to purchase with that. And that is what makes it interesting. It's not what they're making, it's what's missing. For the Latino women, it's 56 cents. So they're getting half of a dollar for the exact same day of work that a man would do. And this impacts them because it impacts the ability to support a household. And that is one of the issues why this gender wage gap is important. If women were paid the same breadwinner wage as men, it would be a lot easier to be able to support that household. You wouldn't necessarily need, well, in this society, you're always going to need the two incomes. And so basically this gender wage gap is a real controversy because some people are arguing, look, it's what women are doing, then some people are saying it's actually the structure. And just to go back a little bit on history, this idea of equal pay, since we started off talking about unions, it actually emerged out of the union labor movement that we were arguing for equal pay for all workers. Didn't necessarily start off focusing on women, but all workers doing a particular job at a particular agency. And one of the women who really talked about equal pay, she talked about poor working conditions and the fact that laborers needed to rise up. This was Mother Jones, and she was an activist in the late 1800s. And what we found on YouTube is just a very, very brief little clip of her speaking. It's supposedly the only clip that they have of her and her actual voice. So let's take a look at what Mother Jones says about labor.
Now, I'm interested in the day when labor will have the best leisure position in their own hands, and the chance to rise to the United States and show the world what the workers can do.
At one time, Mother Jones was called the most dangerous woman in America for her advocating for labor's rights, in particular rights of coal miners and coal miners' families, in terms of making sure they had healthy work conditions there, that they were properly compensated, that the company made the necessary steps to make sure that they were safe. And so I purposely chose not to go all the way back to women and unions. We would just not have enough time. But Mother Jones is one of those figures that sticks out because she was basically talking about basic human equality and fairness for all laborers as they work in different corporations. All right, just to shift gears a little bit before we go to sexual harassment, status is very important. What you do, who you are, where you went to school, what race you are, what gender you are, makes a difference when you go out into the job market. They tell you you have to look a certain way because people are evaluating you. So let's take a look at the next clip on the role of what you look like when you come to a job interview.
NBC.com and Elle magazine shows looks do count when you're at work. Employees say 58% of attractive female bosses are competent at their jobs, while workers say only 23% of unattractive supervisors know what they're doing. The figure is similar for guys, with 61% of good-looking male bosses and only 25% of homely managers being deemed competent. Joining us now is associate editor with Elle magazine, Lili Tan, and it seems kind of comical, like that would actually reflect your ability to do your job, but those were the overwhelming results. Surprising to you?
It wasn't necessarily surprising, but interesting nonetheless. Beauty always sort of confers virtue, and in general, attractive people are perceived to be more competent and smarter, so we just found the same thing in terms of this survey. And unattractive bosses were thought to have gotten their jobs through nepotism and inflated resumes, and attractive bosses were thought to have gotten to where they are because of talent, hard work, social skills, all positive qualities.
Now, the survey also asked about backstabbing, and
yes,
1 in 10 employees admit to stepping on coworkers, so to speak, to get ahead. Are men or women, according to your survey, more guilty of backstabbing behavior?
Surprisingly, it's men, so we shouldn't necessarily expect a stiletto in the back, perhaps a loafer instead. But actually, 4 in 10 people have actually contemplated taking down another coworker, so it's definitely on the mind.
Yikes, watch your back is the moral of that story.
Definitely.
Results, though, show women might be keeping themselves out of the corner office. 3 out of 4 women who had a preference said they prefer working for a man rather than a woman.
Yes, that's true. And I mean, most of the people, about 54% of all of our respondents, said that they didn't care whether they had a man or a woman for a boss and really judged on the individual. So it's just those people who did have a preference who really preferred men over women.
And it looks like women bosses feel like they work harder than their male counterparts.
Yes, about 70% of women bosses felt that they had to work harder or be smarter in order to get the same respect as men. And the men didn't feel the same way. Only about 36% of them felt that women did need to do this. And women sort of got slammed for this. In our open-ended responses, commentary from men, actually, they sounded annoyed by it and felt that women were trying too hard or overcompensating.
So what can we all take away from this as we continue our daily life in the workforce?
I think we can really expect great things because the stereotypes are starting to dissolve. When you ask people directly about what they think about women bosses, they rate just as highly as male bosses do. So as people start working more and having more experiences with female bosses, we should see this more of a gender convergence in terms of management style between men and women.
All right. Lili Tan, thanks so much for being with us.
Thank you for having me.
What is interesting about this clip is that better-looking people actually, not only are they perceived as more competent, they are actually paid more on average. Men who are taller are paid more on average. So when you add all of this, and now think about women in terms of gender roles, in terms of looks, I didn't include it here, but recently there have been several cases where women have been fired for being too sexy and looking too good at the job, which is very, very interesting because you're supposed to look good. And if you can actually find a couple of these clips on YouTube, and, you know, these women are saying they were told at their job they were too curvaceous, Maybe that their breasts were too big, or their hips were too big, or whatever. And one woman came on, she said she always wore business suits. She can't help what she looks like, but she always tried to conduct herself in a business way. But because of what she looked like, they wouldn't let her. And so she spent much of her working day fielding compliments about what she looks like. So when you talk about women and work, there's a lot of issues that come into play then. And so one of the questions from Frank is, does the glass ceiling exist only in the United States? Is equal pay for equal work a global concern? To address your first question, that was one of the things that many of the researchers looked at. And they found the answer to be mixed. Yes, it does exist. Women do seem to be all over the industrialized world locked into lower paying, lower status, less management positions, but the reasons for this seems to change from culture to culture. And so whereas in certain European societies, it is directly related to the choices women are not making. And they are not at all choosing those career tracks that would lead you to administration. And the studies found that the women who did choose those actually did fine. And they went ahead and they got their management positions, but many didn't. Juvenco says, I'm hoping I'm saying your name right, Juvencio. My mother has worked every day of her life as a homemaker. My dad is now retired and my mother is still working. We should value the work at home, whether women or men are doing it. Who will pay the wage? If we do begin to think about women's work at home, Who's going to compensate that? Well, if you think about it, and think about this purely from a sociological perspective, as a society, it is in our best interest to make sure that the women raise their children well. I mean, I would rather have kids that, you know, had somebody at home when they got here, whether it's mother or father. So isn't that something as a society we would want to pay for? We would want to reward it as our society. So status is important. And I included that clip because if something as superficial as looks can determine how people perceive you in terms of your effectiveness. People come into my office all the time. Clearly, I'm an African-American female, and I've had students say, "Oh, Dr. Squires, you're so nice." And I'm like, "What did you expect me to be?" Because they came in with a stereotype of what somebody fitting my characteristics is supposed to be like according to the society. And so looks are important. So compound that with gender roles and gender stereotypes, you have even more of a problem. All right, I want to end today kind of talking about sexual harassment. And I want to go right to our next clip because this is the quintessential understanding of sexual harassment. So let's real quick look at the trailer for 9 to 5.
A tribute to anyone who has ever been overworked, underpaid, and pushed to the edge by an ungrateful boss. They arrive promptly at 9, because if they're not on time, they know they'll get the sack. But before they begin the daily grind, the boss takes his cup black. They remember each date, make sure he's not late, and keep everything organized. They reserve tables for brunch or a 3-martini lunch while they dine on burgers and fries. They listen to all his problems. They do their best to please. And even if they run the show, he gets paid for their ideas.
Great work.
And so long as he's alive, from 9 to 5, they'll take it all they can. But what will go on when the light finally dawns that it's time to get back at that man?
Jane Fonda, Lily Tomlin, and Dolly Parton. 9 to 5.
Think about what that movie was about. These women working hard, trying to support themselves, trying to do everything that is required at that job. And they're getting pinched on the bum. They're getting passes made at them. Their contributions to that office are completely ignored. And the boss kind of lords himself over them as if they're actually paid servants instead of employees. And it really raised the issue of sexual harassment. It raised the issue of workplace respect. And when you think about sexual harassment, just remember a couple of things. We only have 2 minutes. There are more than one different kind. And you can have quid pro quo, like unwelcome sexual advances or requests for a favor in exchange for something. Or you can set up a hostile work environment or, you know, so there's all kind of things. It can be done in terms of language. But what this is basically setting up an environment that makes working secondary. And it becomes difficult to accomplish work because the focus is on something else. And when we start thinking about sexual harassment, we don't have enough time, but I'm going to put this clip on YouTube. This issue of women in the workplace and women being accosted, think about the Popeye cartoon. Popeye cartoon was like one big cartoon for sexual harassment. Wherever Olive Oil was, whether she was in the workplace or in the kitchen or whatever, Bluto was going to be there. But it shows the need for some type of mitigation between males and females in the workplace. When we come back, we are going to talk about relationships on our very last session and how we negotiate that. But think about this. Think about the differences that men and women experience as it relates to work. Their experiences are different. What is going on in the world is being felt differently. Men are seeing a change and a loss, and women are seeing a change as well, but it is a change and a growth, and a change and an infusion into places where they weren't before. So when we come back, we'll wrap up and we'll talk about sweatshops and we'll finally get to our sex work. And your exam is there. I'm going to post your next exam in the next week so you will have it before spring break. And if you have any questions, just send it to me through the discussion board. And I will see you guys later. Bye-bye.